Sir, MRI would give me an idea about the proper extent of the lesion, sir. Is it involving the intra-articular part also, so that I can plan my surgery at a later date?
We can see whether the intra-compartmental or extra-compartmental, that will give you some idea regarding management, yes.
How does MRI help in determining the surgical margin?
Sir.
How does MRI help in determining how much of radius you are going to resect in this patient? In other words, if the proximal margin is in, say about 10 centimeters from the distal end, where will you resect the radius?
Sir, I would like to do a wide resection of the
wide. For a malignant tumor, you do wide resection or radical?
Radical.
Radical resection.
Radical resection.
Now, is it extra compartmental or intra compartmental, the MRI?
So this is an extra compartmental. So we, if we can closely see the MRI, the ulna is also getting encroached by the
high grade extra compartmental lesion.
Yes, sir.
So what is the treatment?
So first I would like to put her on neoadjuvant chemotherapy.
No. If it is low grade intra compartmental, you do a wide excision. If it is high grade intra compartmental, you do a radical excision. This is according to you high grade extra compartmental. What will you do?
Any other non-invasive investigation you will do before you start your treatment?
So bone scan.
Yeah, over. Anything else?
Chest CT
staging.
Scan.
Staging of the disease.
Can there be secondaries?
I would like to get a HRCT of her chest. And a USG of her abdomen.
Yes, it is negative. It is high grade extra compartmental according to you. What will you do? Why do you say extra compartmental?
Sir, the osseous part is involved. Along with that, the surrounding soft tissues and the other bone is also getting involved. So it's in...
The answer to Gobi's question is, I will discuss the management options with the patient's son. That should be the answer. You have the option of going for an amputation, or you can have limb salvage. Each has its own plus points and negative points. So your answer in the exam will be, I will discuss the options with the patient, sir. I have the option of limb salvage and amputation. High grade extra compartmental tumor, the classical treatment is amputation.
Radical resection. Radical resection in this case will amount to?
Amputation.
Amputation.
You have to remove that compartment.
I think we will have to wind up because before I will go to the next case, I will tell you, if it is the background of that situation, you are justified in saying a diagnosis of osteosarcoma, osteomyelitis, and because it is extending to the diaphyseal region, you can also say an Ewing sarcoma. But tuberculosis must be slightly different. And the diagnosis to be confirmed by, of course, biopsy, and as has been said, biopsy is done to confirm, but before that you need to have few adjuvant imaging. An MRI, a bone scan is required, and the type of biopsy which you do today is a core biopsy rather than an incisional biopsy, because the problem with an incisional biopsy, an intracompartmental lesion can be made into an extracompartmental lesion. And if you confirm this is osteosarcoma, what is osteosarcoma? Osteoid lined by malignant osteoblast is osteosarcoma, irrespective of what it contains other than that. And the type of osteosarcomas are classical osteosarcoma, periosteal osteosarcoma, periosteal osteosarcoma, secondary osteosarcoma, which is occurring in Paget's disease or radiation. And when you are talking about osteosarcoma, it is only classical osteosarcoma. The treatment of osteosarcoma is in a strict global protocol. You do a biopsy, as has been said, you have to stage. This is metastatic or non-metastatic. This requires a chest x-ray plus a CT scan. And if it is a non-metastatic, you do the neoadjuvant chemotherapy, which contains adriamycin, cisplatin, and ifosfamide. 3 doses, 3-week interval, and minimum of 3 courses to be given. This is to reduce any micrometastasis which has occurred into the pulmonary system, that also reduce the bulk of the tumor, and also
give a plane of surgical clearance. So this is required for two reasons. One, to eliminate micrometastasis in the lung. Two, reduce the tumor bulk, which will give a space for surgery. Then do an extra compartmental removal of the tumor and reconstruct wherever is possible. Reconstruction depends upon the site and things, followed by three courses of the same drug. So this is all completely globally acceptable protocol. So the method of approach to the problem has to be right. So he has been spent a lot of time to say this is osteosarcoma with clear clinical finding. The next thing should not be a jumping biopsy. You need to have some information. So that is the way it should be. There is no harm in saying osteosarcoma, but you should be prepared to accept this is an osteomyelitis as well. Even if you say osteomyelitis, I don't doubt that you will be penalized to pull you down because of the duration of symptoms.
This case will be chaired by Dr. Rajesh from CMC Calicut and Dr. Gopal Krishnan from SGT Medical College.
So the case of 11 years old girl coming from Calicut, she's studying in 7th standard, right dominant person, complains of stiffness of her left elbow for last 1 month duration.
Whole case before we start questioning about anything. So you finish it.
So person complains complaints of stiffness left elbow for the last 1 month duration. She had history of fall 2 months back on outstretched left hand. Following she had pain and swelling of the left elbow. She was taken to nearby hospital, was taken x-ray and was told to have a fracture. She was given plaster of Paris immobilization with forearm in the straight position for 3 weeks under anesthesia. POP was put under anesthesia and was immobilized for 3 weeks. After 3 weeks, the removal of plastering was done and she developed the difficulty in bending her forearm and turning her palm outwards forwards. Then she was advised physiotherapy for 2 more weeks, 15 days, following which she had some improvement in her movements. She had some bending movement restored and some movement of the palm moving outwards. At present, she has got difficulty in dressing up, in having eating problems also, and personal hygienic activities. Going to the log examination. Attitude: the patient is sitting comfortably on the couch with the left upper limb by the side of the body, shoulder adducted, elbow extended, forearm pronated. Forearm mid prone position with the palm facing medially. Local examination anteriorly, the skin was found to be normal and comparable to the opposite side. There is no abnormal swelling, sinuses or scars, and the bony prominence of the lateral, posterior and medial aspects were found to be comparable with the opposite side. Now going to palpation, there is no local rise of temperature. Then tenderness present over the lateral epicondyle anconeus triangle over the radial head and posteromedial joint line. The supracondylar ridges were normal. There were no abnormal thickening or tenderness. The olecranon, there was no abnormality or increased prominence or thickness or irregularity, and the subcutaneous border of ulna was also palpated normally. Now going to the movements, movements is painless with flexion from 0 to 30 degrees, further limited by pain and spasm, extension 0 degree, pronation 0 to 40 degree, further restricted by pain and spasm. and supination 0 degree. So the supination pronation movements were checked in the available position of elbow flexion, that is at 30 degrees of elbow flexion. Now going to the measurements, length measurements, medial.
Can you repeat supination pronation?
Supination pronation I did in 30 degree available flexion. I mean I could not, her flexion is not up to 90 degrees. So I checked it in extension and 30 degrees of flexion.
How much of supination is present?
Supination is 0 degree, sir.
No. 0 degree. Pronation?
Pronation is 0 to 40 degree.
0 to 40 degree.
Now going to the measurements, the medial and lateral column length measurements of the arm and forearm were comparable to the opposite side. There was no circumferential difference in the measurement of both sides. 3-point relationship, I measured it in 30 degrees of flexion only, as I could not flex it to 90 degrees, and it is also found equal bilaterally. And the angular measurement, carrying angle, I could not measure it because she has no supination movement and hand is in prone position, forearm is in mid prone position. In the available position it was equal to equal bilaterally. There was no DRUG instability. Ipsilateral shoulder was found to be within normal limits. There was no distal neurovascular deficit. So diagnosis.
Before you say the diagnosis, let me clarify. Can the elbow fully extended?
Yeah, up to 0.
Fully extended?
Yes, sir. Neutral position, I can keep it there.
You mean the elbow can be fully extended?
Yes.
Fully extended?
Yes.
Can you show the left elbow whether she is fully extending?
Can you control the elbow?
Is she able to extend it fully?
No.
That is a gross error. You were commenting that about carrying angle.
Yes.
Huh? What is the carrying angle?
The difference in the longitudinal axis angular.
You can't measure the carrying angle if the elbow is in flexion deformity. Isn't it?
Yes.
Two fundamental error.
I felt like extension is 0 degrees.
There is no excuse to incomplete clinical examination. These are all MBBS level cases only, and if you are in the postgraduate level, doesn't matter you make a diagnosis of osteosarcoma or osteomyelitis. You must be able to see clinical findings. So you started off by there is no elbow fully extended. This elbow is about 30 degree, 20 degree, 25 degree of extension lag.
So there is a flexion deformity. There is a flexion deformity of the elbow around 25 to 30 degrees. You keep the arm on the table and try to extend. Probably the method of examination you did is wrong.
Kept it like.
You just did like this. So you have seen the demonstration. You keep the arm.
Kept it like this only.
No, you keep the arm over the table. Both humerus on the table. Humerus on the table and now extend. Extend the normal side first. Now extend the other side. Without lifting. Yes, what is your inference?
There's flexion deformity is present.
Fixed flexion deformity. Around 25 to 30 degrees. Now free flexion. From there, free flexion. How many degrees?
Nearly 20-30 degrees. 20?
If you are actually making an error on that, that will reflect very badly on your result. You are a bit casual. That's why you have missed. The methodology of examination has to be pakka and should be expressed in front of the examiner without any ambiguity. And these are, her diagnosis will be based on that. So why did you make a mistake? Then you also commented about carrying angle. And somebody who can't extend the elbow fully cannot have a carrying angle measure.
And also it will be, if you remember.
What about the three bony province relations, three bony bone relations posterior?
In the available position, flexion, it was found to be comparable to the opposite side.
It is comparable? Comparable.
Yes.
But here there is limitation of flexion. She cannot flex. There is no, you cannot extend it fully. How can you compare the relationship?
You said the subcutaneous border of the ulna is normal.
Yes.
What about the olecranon?
Olecranon was also found to be normal.
So. Is the prominence equal to the other side or is it more prominent, less prominent? What about the ulna now? What about the supracondylar ridges? What about the position of the radial head? And you did not mention anything regarding the instability also. You just test for varus and valgus.
Valgus instability is...
Valgus, you said that?
No, I haven't.
Can you see a thickening on the lateral side and anterior side of the elbow? Bony mass-like structure on the lateral side. Can you feel it? Or on the front?
So
what is there in the examiner's mind when somebody asks a question like that? Abnormal mass around the elbow.
Gobi, he has not commented anything in his palpation to explain the patient's clinical find.
Prompting you to examine the elbow again to look for any abnormal mass around, because he has so much anteriorly.
Basically, this patient is having severe limitation of elbow movements.
Yes.
She is also having restriction of supination pronation.
Yes.
So in your examination, you have to find out the cause. Why there is limitation of elbow movement? There has to be an intra-articular problem within the elbow.
Yes.
Because the supination pronation is restricted, there has to be a problem with the either radial or joint. So you have to identify that. This patient may be having a radial dislocation. She may be having myositis ossificans. So you have to focus your examination to find out any such problems that is present in this patient.
The palpated ulnar nerve.
Yeah, no thickening was found.
So palpated?
No. Yes, I have palpated.
Not palpable.
Can you palpate anteriorly? Can you palpate anteriorly and find out whether there is any and compare with the normal side? Anterior palpation with the forearm and supination, just palpate.
Yes, just
yes, did you find any mass?
Yes.
There is a growing impression on the students, say that I have said the correct diagnosis. The examiner was biased because he failed me. Because the correct diagnosis. There is no value to be given if the clinical diagnosis is based on clinical finding.
So in your presentation itself, you should be giving sufficient amount of findings which will justify the diagnosis. In the previous case, the diagnosis was osteosarcoma, but findings were not given which is suggestive of it being an osteosarcoma.
What's your diagnosis?
Post-traumatic elbow stiffness.
Reason for stiffness? Is it dislocation? Is it subluxation? Is it fracture dislocation? Is it radial head fracture?
Is it myositis?
Can you palpate the radial head in the normal position?
You said that initially the limb was plastered for 3 weeks or 1 month.
3 weeks.
3 weeks. So there must have been some skeletal injury. What would have been the primary?
She was told to have fracture from there. From the hospital.
What fracture? What fracture?
Most common injury. Around supracondylar common.
Is there a supracondylar?
No.
What binding?
Radial.
If it is a supracondylar fracture, supination pronation usually will be not normal.
Complex elbow dislocation.
Traumatic stiffness diagnosis.
What findings is present in your examination to say that it is a dislocated elbow?
You can't say at the postgraduate examination post-traumatic stiffness. The patient had a trauma. the patient says, I have loss of movement. You are saying the patient's complaint.
So in your diagnosis, you have to identify what happened on the day of injury. What fracture was present. And now, why the patient is having all these difficulties. What is the cause for all her symptoms? Why the movements are so much restricted? So there has to be a complication. So you have to identify the primary injury and you have to identify what complication is present.
So your diagnosis is post-traumatic stiffness. There should be a reason for stiffness. What is it? Is it myositis? Is it unreduced subluxation? Unreduced dislocation?
Can be
fracture separation, epiphyseal injury, divergent dislocation. You select anyone among these.
What is the total duration?
Yes, sir.
Total duration?
2 months now.
2 months. Plaster removed, 1.5 months back.
When you say post-traumatic, you have to say at least this thing. This elbow is ankylosed or fibrous ankylosed or stiff due to an intra-articular cause or an extra-articular cause. And by excluding an intra-articular or extra-articular can be arrived upon. So that is why the question, if it is an intra-articular cause, this is an unreduced posterior dislocation, is an intra-articular cause. Will you say this is an unreduced posterior dislocation?
My examination findings?
No, that is an intra-articular cause. Can this be an unreduced posterior dislocation?
If it is a dislocation, what will be the three bony point relationship?
Olecranon will be more prominent. And
three bony prominent relation in a dislocation.
It will be lost.
So usually the dislocation is posterior. Yes. Posterior dislocation itself can be posterior medial or posterior lateral. So the intercondylar width will be normal. But the distance from the medial epicondyle to the olecranon or olecranon to the lateral condyle, that will be different depending upon whether it is a posterior medial or a posterior lateral subluxation.
Then you may be given the diagnosis, like the previous case on the announcement, next is an osseous sarcoma case. So we wanted to the student examine in such a way and make clinical findings to fit in with that diagnosis.
Any other diagnosis apart from supracondylar fracture? Think of common things. Next common injury around elbow in a child.
No native treatment, nothing.
You palpated the proximal ulna, any deformity?
No, I could not find any deformity.
Radial head in position.
I found
radial head. Radial head.
I felt it in the normal position.
You can feel an irregularity there. And I feel that there is some prominence of the olecranon also. There is irregularity of the radial head also. So what will you do now? You are not able to tell a diagnosis.
I'll take an X-ray of the X-ray of the elbow.
X-ray is there.
Both radius and ulna. The AP view, the distal humerus found to be normal.
Subluxation.
Joint line, there is no joint space narrowing.
There is a
united fracture of the radial neck is present. In the lateral view, the ulnohumeral subluxation.
United or malunited?
Malunited fracture, some angular. Malunited fracture of the radial neck.
So what is your radiological diagnosis?
What is the relationship between
is it a simple radial head fracture or is there something else?
It's a semilunar notch of ulna sitting over the humerus. Yes.
What is the relationship?
Is it congruent?
No, sir.
Humeral ulnar relation.
Might be a Mondesi variant type of.
In the AP view, you can see the olecranon fossa.
There is a dislocation.
Olecranon is lying medially.
Yes.
AP view, you can see the AP view.
AP view.
Lateral view also, you can see the gap.
There is a humero-ulnar dissociation. There is a subluxation of the elbow. There is a fracture of the
radial neck.
Radial head, not head.
Neck.
Neck. With angulation, it's small united and the subluxation is not corrected. So what will you do now?
What is your radiological diagnosis now?
Malunited radial neck fracture with ulnohumeral subluxation. Huh? Malunited radial neck fracture with ulnohumeral subluxation.
Abnormality?
Ulnohumeral subluxation.
Elbow subluxation.
He means an elbow dislocation.
Was it an elbow dislocation with radial head fracture initially? Radial neck fracture.
It can be.
And the elbow is probably partially reduced.
Yes.
Even now it is in a sublux position.
So what will you do now? What will you do?
Take a CT scan to...
The CT scan shows the same. Elbow subluxation, radial neck fracture. What will you do?
Now to...
CT scan is available?
Why you want a CT scan?
To find any cause for this irreducibility, any osteochondral fragments, interposition.
Osteochondral fragments.
And also you want to rule out a fracture of the capitulum?
Capitulum.
Or trochlea. Yes. Now CT report has come just like this. Subluxation, radial neck fracture. What will you do?
Open reduction.
Of what? Open reduction of fracture radial neck?
I'll try open reduction of the elbow joint.
If you do open reduction of only elbow joint or the fracture also?
Will you accept the malunion? That is you're asking.
What is the forearm rotations? Is it limited or is it normal?
Forearm rotation is limited.
So can you accept?
Malunion also has to be corrected.
It is malunited and that is the cause for the limitation of forearm supination pronation. So that also needs
correction
to be addressed.
Okay, what is the approach? Anterior, posterior, lateral? You approach both through the same incision or different incision?
Posterolateral approach can be.
When will you operate?
Sir?
When will you post the case for surgery? Immediately or wait for some time?
I will not wait, sir. I will do it immediately.
You will operate as early as possible. But can you see any myositis mass around?
Myositis?
Mass. Myositis? Radiologically?
Could not.
No.
Say.
No.
Okay. Here, the pathological anatomy is not completely demonstrated in the X-ray. So there is a suggestion of humero-ulnar dissociation and there is definitely neck of radius fracture, but the amount of mobility loss have to be identified. The amount of mobility loss. So it is worthwhile if you are going to contemplate a surgical solution to this elbow when it is almost completely stiff. It is important to know what is the pathological anatomy of the elbow and the proximal radio-ulnar joint. A CT scan of the elbow will be the only way you are going to assess the pathological anatomy, then only you can plan appropriately.
What is your diagnosis?
Spastic diplegia.
Spastic?
Diplegia secondary to cerebral palsy in a 9-year-old child. Who walks with a crouch gait and a scissoring gait.
He walks? Yes.
With support. He walks with support.
Number one, you said he's having cerebral palsy. Second, diplegia. Substantiate your diagnosis. Why cerebral palsy? Why do you say it is diplegia?
It is cerebral palsy because the problem started from the birth. There was a delayed cry at the time of birth. And patient's motor milestones were delayed. Patient has episode of seizures for which he is on treatment. And the deformity is...
Physical examination findings.
You told spastic. Spastic. Yes. But he has got both flail angles. Angles are all flail. Can you see that?
Yes, sir.
It can move in any direction. And there is no clonus when I examine.
there is
and spastic. the limb looks very flaccid. Then why do you say spastic?
There is spasticity of the hip and knee muscles. There is hip flexor flexion attitude and knee flexion attitude.
No, flexion attitude could be due to contractures. Need not be spastic. Why do you say it is spastic? Because it looks very flail. All the joints are very flail. You can put in any direction and it does not produce any spasm. It goes in for external internal rotation. And there are some contractures here and there, that's sure. But why do you say it is spastic? What findings made you think that it is spastic paraparesis? By clonus?
The resistance to the movement increases with the rapidity of the...
There is no clonus.
There is no clonus.
There is no accelerated reflexes.
Oh, sir. The knee jerk is exaggerated, sir. There is no patellar clonus, but the knee jerk is exaggerated.
Knee jerk is normal. Can you demonstrate it? This is a normal knee jerk.
Okay, sir.
It's not exaggerated.
Okay, sir.
And this side you see? Just because there is a flexion contracture of the knee, you should not say that it is spastic. That could be due to contracture. This is a normal knee jerk.
Yes, sir.
Ankle jerk is absent.
Yes, sir.
Absent.
Ankle jerk is absent, sir.
Absent. Yes. This you are just rotating it. Now this is a contracture. Yes.
Okay.
There can be some hamstring spasm, but generally it is not as spastic as the spastic paraparesis. What are the tests you have done? You told muscles around the hip are spastic. Did you do Ellis test?
Yes, sir. Ellis prone test is positive, sir. Then Ober's test is negative. Phelps test is positive for
Ober's
gracilis. Ober's test is negative.
Ober's test is negative.
Negative.
This hip can be brought into any position, internal, external. There is no external rotation contracture.
Okay, sir.
There is no abduction contracture. So you look for other tests. Ellis test is correct.
Yes, then, sir. Phelps test is positive, sir.
Yes, I will do Phelps test, modified Phelps test. You have done modified or normal Phelps test?
I don't
what
know.
What does
difference.
It indicate? Phelps test positive means what?
It indicates gracilis tightness, sir.
When you demonstrate Phelps test, modified,
yes,
Phelps test.
Yes, sir. We do it in the prone position.
No, in supine itself you can do. That is why modified.
Okay, sir. We flex the knee.
Yes.
And then abduct the hip, and with extension of the knee, the hip will come into adduction.
Did you follow, audience? How to do modified Phelps test? Have you followed? No, they did not understand. They did not understand this.
So we flex.
It is a test for tight gracilis or medial hamstrings. So what you do is, you try to extend the knee. At one point, you will have to adduct the limb to extend the knee. Understand? You start in this position, you try to extend the knee. In order to extend the knee, if you want to adduct the hip, then that is a positive test. Do you understand? So I am not able to extend the knee now. The limb is in, hip is in abduction, I am not able to extend. Now, I want to extend, but I cannot extend. So what? I'll try to adduct and extend. Now I am able to extend little more. Why is it so? Because medial hamstrings is a muscle which crosses two joints, the hip and the knee. So when I abduct, this is tight, the adductors are tight. It is, the hamstrings are tight here. It is inserted below the knee. So when I put it in little adduction, then the hamstrings are relaxed, I am able to extend it again. When you do it in prone position, it is called Phelps test. When you do like this, it is called modified Phelps test. It's a test for
Tightness of the gracilis.
Medial hamstring.
That can be done in the hip joint also. Abduction.
Yeah.
Hip abduction will be more when the knee is
flexed.
When you abduct the hip, the knee flexion will increase. That is a corollary.
So what are the contractures, what are the deformities in the hip joint?
Has he got there, is an there is an adduction contracture, sir.
Adduction contracture, how can you say? It's combined adduction. That is what you usually see, combined abduction. Combined abduction is almost 90 degree.
So there is no adductor spasm.
It doesn't require any treatment for that.
There is no adductor spasm. Usually expect adductor spasm, scissoring gait, flexion. So he has got only some contracture of the hamstrings, some spasm of the hamstrings. Generally speaking, it is a flaccid paraparesis, except for some mild hamstring tightness.
Yes, sir.
Any other test you have done?
He has got a flexion deformity in the hips.
There is no fixed flexion deformity, sir. It's only flexion attitude.
How can you say?
There is no exaggerated lumbar lordosis.
You take the patient.
Free extension.
How do you know? Already there is a fixed flexion deformity in the hip.
There is a flexion attitude,
you
sir.
You bring the patient to the edge of the table.
No, no,
only
not,
you
not
can say that. It's not necessary. And in this position, see whether the lumbar lordosis is exaggerated or not. Just see, first see whether the there is exaggeration of lumbar lordosis. If it is there,
very minimal.
It's not exaggerated. It's not exaggerated.
Is this?
There is
some exaggeration appears to be there. Sir.
Looks normal.
Okay. Okay. So the problem in the hip is?
No.
Not much problem.
So his main problem is some hamstring contracture and tightness.
What about the knee joint? What problem?
There is a hamstring contracture in
is
the knee
it
joint.
Contracture or spasm or both? How will you know?
A spasm can be overcome passively.
Which test you will do?
Popliteal angle, sir.
Demonstrate.
The hip inflection, we...
How much flexion hip?
90-degree flexion.
90-degree flexion.
We attempt to extend the knee, sir.
Yes.
And the angle formed between the...
That is the first resistance.
Sorry, sir?
First resistance. And then apply steady pressure and see whether there is an improvement.
Yes, sir.
That component is due to spasm.
Yes, sir.
In this case, there is no improvement.
Yes, sir.
That means it's contracture only.
Yes, sir.
No spasm. Okay.
So you use silver skewl test. What is that? Silver skewl test.
Equinus deformity. She is having equinus.
There is no fixed deformity, sir.
See with the knee in extension. Possible extension. Try to dorsiflex the ankle. Is it coming to the neutral?
It is just coming beyond neutral with the knee in maximum extension.
See it in flexion of the knee.
With the flexion of the knee, the dorsiflexion is improving, sir.
What does it mean? Which test is positive?
This is silver skewl test positive, sir.
What does it indicate?
It indicates that the contracture is present both in the gastrocnemius and the soleus. It is not completely normal. It is improving, sir.
More contracture in?
See, if you flex and if you are not able to dorsiflex completely, what does it mean?
It means the contracture is present only in the soleus.
This is more contraction in gastrocnemius, isn't it?
When you extend the knee, all this, when you extend the knee, I am not able to bring just to neutral.
Yes.
But when I flex it, I can completely dorsiflex it.
What does it mean?
What does it mean?
Which muscle is component is in
predominantly in the gastrocnemius.
Gastrocnemius, okay.
Okay, what will you do for this case? What will you do?
What about the gait?
The gait is an assisted gait, sir. Patient walks with a...
Can you demonstrate?
You said it is crouch and scissoring.
Yes, sir.
There is not likely to be a scissoring gait in this case because there is combined abduction more than 90 degree.
Yes, sir.
And no spasm also.
No scissoring. There is no scissoring because it is not crossing the midline.
No scissoring there.
His main problem is a flexion deformity in the knee.
In crouch gait, the position of the angle will be in?
In equine.
It's coming to the midline.
No, it has to cross.
It has to cross the midline completely. No, coming to the midline.
It has to cross.
Okay.
This is not a typical scissoring gait. What is the position of the angle in a crouch gait?
Dorsiflexion.
Dorsiflexion.
The spine and the upper limbs are sitting balance.
Yeah, you have to see whether the child is able to have a sitting balance. Is it having?
Sitting balance is there, sir. It's normal, sir.
Show that.
The child can sit with the trunk symmetrical, with
balance. Without support.
Without support, sir.
So what will you do? What will you do?
I'd like to do a.
What is your aim of doing the surgery in this child?
The aim of doing the surgery will be to straighten the limb.
Do you want any X-ray of the hip or like that? Don't want. X-ray of the knee.
Why do you want to get the X-ray of the hip joint in a cerebral palsy, especially if there is an adduction contracture?
To look for subtle subluxations or dysplasia.
Subluxation. Subluxation.
You will take X-ray before surgery or after surgery?
Before
surgery. Is there any X-ray?
And then
under anesthesia, you are able to extend any fully. That's your under anesthesia examination result. What will you do?
Then we'll give a tone inhibiting cast in that extension.
You are able to extend it completely under anesthesia. What does it mean?
That means
it is a spasticity and it's not a contracture.
What are the measures by which you can correct a spasm?
Muscle relaxants.
Anything else? No, muscle relaxant will help in this child. Medication will help.
Any injections?
No.
Any injection? Injections?
Local injection.
What
of
is it?
Botulinum toxin into the spastic muscles.
Okay. Muscles.
And then?
And physiotherapy, stretching exercises and splinting.
You get a temporary relief. After that, it comes back like this. What will you do?
We have to advise the parents that it's a lifelong problem and it can come back.
Lifelong, life,
sir. The adductor longus is released.
Adductor tenotomy along with that, any other procedure you can do?
We will do an obturator neurectomy if the patient is non-ambulatory.
Hey, in this case, there is no adduction deformity. You do only around the knee. What will you do around the knee? Botulinum injected, temporary relief is there, but patient comes back with the same problem. What will you do?
We have to do a fractional lengthening and then
fit it to
caliper.
Which muscle? Fractional lengthening or release or transfer?
All the hamstrings?
Medial hamstrings, sir. Semimembranosus.
Medial hamstrings only.
Yes.
What will happen if you release all the hamstrings?
There will be weakness of knee flexion and
this child will go in for geno recurvatum.
He will go
so
for
be careful.
Opposite deformity.
Yes.
You should not correct the deformity completely.
And patient will not have even this gait.
Oh.
Yes.
He will not be able to walk again.
Yes.
So you want to do a fractional lengthening of the gastrocnemius also. Or what procedure you will do for gastrocnemius?
For a complete release.
Proximal transfer of medial hamstrings or a set plasty of medial hamstrings or a complete cut. Just release it. What will you do?
Tenotomy.
Tenotomy. All have medial hamstrings?
Not sure, sir. Semite?
You should not release
all the medial hamstrings.
No, all the medial hamstrings you should not release. You stage wise first.
Fraction little.
Yeah. And then you see which has to be released. And then on the table you assess.
Gastrocnemius, what will you do? Gastrocnemius, will you do a tendoculus lengthening?
Probably that can be, spasm can be overcome by physiotherapy and stretching, sir. We would
patch it. It is not?
Because already the plantar flexor is weak, sir. It's only 1/5.
They will not do anything about gastrocnemius?
Yes, sir.
Okay. If you want to do something, what will you do? Is it tendoculus lengthening or some other procedure?
If it is gastrocnemius, contracture predominantly we release at the
gastrocnemius recession.
Yes. Recessions.
What is a better method? Gastrocnemius means it is a posterior stabilizer of the knee. So there is a complete contracture and spasm of the gastrocnemius. So what will you do? There is an equinus deformity. What will you do? You release the hamstrings and tendoculus or you do something else?
Last question.
Last question.
Sorry, sir. Don't.
If there is an equinus contracture, the soleus, gastrocnemius contracture. You do a anterior advancement of the tendoculus. Advancement.
Suppose this child requires surgery on both ankles, both knees. Which one you will do first?
the knee first, sir.
No, that is not the answer. Do you know what is single-level, multi-level surgery?
Okay.
That is the procedure to be done. All correct, all the deformities simultaneously. Okay. Yes.
Okay, you did a nice presentation.
Good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon, everyone. I'm Rohit. Today I'll be presenting this case. Mr. Balakrishnan, aged 20 years old, from Wayanad. He's a student by profession. Comes with chief complaints of giving away of the right knee for the past 5 months. History of presenting illness. The patient was apparently normal 5 months back when he sustained an injury to the right knee while playing football. The mechanism of injury, according to the patient, was he was wearing new shoes, his foot was stationary, and there was a sudden slipping and following which he had a fall. Following the incident, he
doctor,
was...
one second, we'll go, because when at the end of the exams, normally, what we ask is, what is your diagnosis?
Yes, sir.
What's your diagnosis?
Anterior instability of the knee joint, probably due to ACL, complete ACL rupture.
Why do you say so?
According to the history, sir, based on the history, he gives a characteristic history of injury while playing football, where the foot was stable on the ground, and then there was a forward.
Findings on examination which suggest there is ACL injury.
Yes, sir. On inspection, there is only a mild swelling. There is wasting
of... the points only in favor of your diagnosis of ACL injury.
Some specific points. Sir is asking specific, yes, points of...
On palpation, anterior drawer test is positive. The Lachman's test is positive, sir. And pivot shift test is positive.
Yeah, demonstrate the anterior drawer test. Important thing is you have to tell the patient that you are going to sit there.
Yes.
Where will you first put your fingers?
I'm going to palpate the joint line, sir. Once I reach the joint line, I'll give...
Where is the thumb? Thumbs?
At the joint line, sir.
Yeah. Yes. What next you do?
Sorry, sir?
What next you do?
I give a pressure, anterior pressure.
Before that, you have to palpate the hamstrings and see that...
There's no spasm. Yes, sir.
And third step is you keep the thumb there.
Is it positive?
Yes, sir.
You always compare with the other side before, yes, you say that it is positive, because it may be a ligamentous laxity.
Ligamentous laxity was checked in general physical examination.
Unless you compare with the other side, you cannot say it is positive. What is your inference?
There's a laxity on the right side, sir. When compared to the left side.
Laxity or some other word you use?
Laxity.
What is the word you use? Translation.
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 Yes. Suppose it is negative, but yes, still you think that there is instability. What test you will do?
What is the next test?
I can do a Lachman's test.
Yeah, do that.
Sometimes it will be negative, anterior drawer, and this will be positive. What is the reason?
The bow.
Door stopper.
Because of the meniscus, door stopper effect, or hemarthrosis, yeah, in the acute stages. Kaal full la loose vechukonga. Loose vechukonga.
He asked him to put.
Loose with.
Can you appreciate that?
Yes,
positive. Is it positive?
It's positive.
Compared to the operative.
Yes, which other test you will do? Slocum's test. What is that? Slocum's test?
I haven't done it, sir.
Slocum's test.
No, is there one more test?
Because he cannot demonstrate, so you can demonstrate for him.
Slow.
It's a rotatory.
Give the mic to him.
Which type of rotatory?
It's antromedial rotatory instability. we do it in we do give an anterior anterior translation force with internal rotation at the leg.
How many degrees?
30 degrees.
No, it is not 30 degree.
15 degrees. External rotation is 30 degree.
Okay.
Yes, no, it do that. 15 degrees. No, it is more.
What is the position of the knee? 90 degree.
90 degree knee.
As you do the anterior drawer
similar
test.
Similar to anterior drawer
just
test.
Do it. First okay. Anterior drawer test.
Then rotate.
Negative.
Then internally rotate 15 degree. Do anterior drawer.
Yes, sir. I will rotate.
Then externally rotate 30 degree. Do anterior drawer. That is Slocum's test. Now, what is the inference?
Okay. Yes, it's here. Okay, keep the foot in internal rotation. 15 degrees of internal rotation. Then sit over here.
Yes, sir.
And then you see this. Then you rotate it as 30 degrees. Again, do this.
Okay. Yes.
Did you follow? Every one of you know what is Slocum's test? Yes. Now, what is the inference? Suppose there is laxity in neutral position and it is more with internal rotation. What is your inference?
It's the anteromedial structures are weak.
Internal rotation.
Internal rotation is anterolateral.
No, what are the structures damaged? It is positive in neutral, more positive in internal rotation. What are the structures damaged? What are structures damaged? Anterior cruciate ligament, lateral collateral ligament, and lateral capsular ligament. Now, you do the same in external rotation. And the test is more positive than neutral. What does it mean?
ACL, MCL.
Anteromedial instability. The structures damaged are? ACL. MCL. Medial collateral ligament,
anteromedial
and
capsule.
Medial capsular ligament. Yes, this you should know.
Yes.
Any other test you have done? Pivot shifts. You know pivot shift? Pivot shift pivot. Test. You know?
Yes, sir. I've done pivot shifts. Sir.
You know it?
Yes, sir.
The demonstrate. On the normal side, you yes.
Is it positive in this case?
Yes, sir.
Now you are rotating the whole limb internally, the rotation occurs at the hip joint. Can anybody demonstrate the pivot shift? Should not rotate the whole limb, it goes at the level of hip.
We keep the limb in, we internal rotate the knee and give a valgus thrust. And bring the knee from extension to flexion. With interlocated position, a valgus thrust resists.
Is it only internal rotation?
Usually, that's what I mean.
It is internal rotation and abduction.
Okay. Yes. Internal
rotation. All valgus.
Valgus thrust.
Valgus.
Internal rotation and valgus. It is all. It will be in a subluxated position and it will relocate
at
70 degrees of
30 degrees.
30 degrees.
30
degrees.
Flexion.
30 degrees.
Why it relocates at 30 degrees? Why it relocates at 30 degrees?
Internal rotation.
What causes the relocation?
ITB. The IT band, intact IT band.
Yes.
And then gets reduced. What is jerk test? J-E-R-K. Jerk test. You start the same test from flexion. At 30 degree, what happens? It subluxates. In pivot shift, it reduces at 30 degree. In jerk test, it subluxates. So one started from flexion, the other started from
extension.
Both the same. It's a test for anterolateral instability. Is it positive? You test on the other side. Is it positive?
No, sir.
It's negative.
It's usually positive under anesthesia.
You said it is positive. Can you demonstrate that?
Negative.
It is negative. I also got negative. He also got negative.
Is that a positive, sir? I want
to know. There should be a lateral laxity to produce that test. Did you do varus valgus stress test in flexion and extension?
Yes, sir.
What is your inference?
There is no varus and valgus stress test negative.
Yeah. Then can you get a pivot shift test?
You won't get if there is no.
Did you understand?
Yes, sir.
He got varus valgus stress test
negative.
With, normal. And then he told that pivot shift test is positive. Can it happen? It cannot happen. Now, how will you do varus valgus stress test? Demonstrate on the normal side first. First you do in extension and then you do in 30 degree flexion. If it is negative in extension, positive in 30 degrees of flexion, what does it mean?
It's more specific for collateral injury.
What does it mean?
It's more specific for a collateral injury.
Isolated collateral ligament injury. If it is positive in extension also? ACL. ACL and lateral collateral
injury. Varus stressed and then valgus.
Yeah. Okay. What is your final diagnosis?
Anterior instability of the knee joint secondary to ACL injury.
So it's a diagnosis anterior instability, anterior cruciate ligament injury. What will you do?
First, I'll get an X-ray now.
X-ray, sir.
Why do you want to get an X-ray?
Hamstrings.
What
so
yes?
Initially, hamstring weakness is there, sir. So I would advise for exercises, strengthening exercises, yes, followed by that.
So you will go for an arthroscopic ACL reconstruction after strengthening the hamstrings and quadriceps, both?
Yes, sir. Both? No, sir. With a both graft that would be preferred would be hamstring tendon graft.
Next case.
Thank
so
you.
So we'll move on to the next case.
Who mobilized like this?
My question.
This is close. Another one, foot also moves. Which is better? Close chain exercise or better?
Why is it so? Why close chain is better? Diagnosis could be synovitis, arthritis,
bony ankylosis of the right knee. With
ankylosis. Okay. Yes, your diagnosis is bony ankylosis and radiological diagnosis.
Okay.
Your diagnosis is an ankylosed
knee.
Ankylosed knee. In acceptable position or unacceptable position?
In unacceptable position.
Acceptable.
Unacceptable.
Unacceptable. It's a sound ankylosis or unsound ankylosis?
It's a sound ankylosis.
What do you mean by sound?
There is no pain.
So it's a sound ankylosis in an unacceptable position.
Yes.
Why do you say so?
Because the patient is not able to walk without support. She is not able to do his routine daily activities. She is not able to sit squat or sit cross leg.
Yes. What is the reason for this ankylosis?
What the diagnosis is not cause? Complete. What do you think the cause for this?
It's following a septic sequelae. She gives a history of means fever with chills and rigor at the age of 5. And following she was treated in local hospital for about 3 months.
Why she has
months.
Come now?
Now since the last 1 year she is having pain over both her hips.
Oh, so for hip pain?
Hip pain.
Okay.
So do you think a patient with unacceptable ankylosis, for example ankylosis in unacceptable position in the knee, present with hip pain after some time, what could be the reason? Has got a short limb in flexion. Functionally this is a short limb in flexion.
Short limb.
So what will happen to the hip?
Secondary osteoarthritis.
Which hip will be affected usually? Oscillator clip or opposite?
Opposite hip will be affected.
Why is it so? Why opposite hip?
Because the center of gravity will be shifted more.
No. It's not a center of gravity which is a problem.
Joint reaction force will be more on the effect.
Now this hip, this knee is ankylosed in flexion.
Yes.
And it's very short.
Yes.
So what will happen when she stands on that? What will happen to the opposite hip? What will happen? What is happening to my opposite hip?
It's a...
When I stand like this, what's happening? This is a very short limb in flexion.
Yes. So weight will be more trans.
Effect is severe adduction of the?
Adduction of the opposite.
So what will happen to that hip?
Yes.
If one hip goes in for adduction, What will happen? What's happening in CP when there is severe adduction deformity?
It becomes a cross like means.
Now what will happen to the ball and socket?
It will be deformed. It will point concentration of the weight.
It will subluxate and finally it will get dislocated, and then that could be the reason. So what will you do now?
To investigate.
Yes.
Take up.
What investigation?
What investigation?
So do a blood routine examination.
X-ray. You ask for an X-ray.
Any other
So your diagnosis is confirmed?
Yes, sir.
Why do you say it is bony ankylosis from the X-ray?
There is no joint.
What are you seeing?
What I see?
Positive. What is continuous?
Medulla is
trabecular continuity from the femur to the tibia.
Okay.
So trabecular cross the joint, there is no joint line seen, so it's bony ankylosis. As for pelvis X-ray? X-ray pelvis. Yes, what has happened to that opposite hip?
It's subluxated.
What is the reason for subluxation now?
That is adduction of
Look
the
at the hip. What has happened to the pelvis?
Yes, there is a tilting of the pelvis, right?
So this side is always in?
It's an adduction.
Adduction.
So that pelvis is at a lower level. What is the reason for that?
It's abduction.
What is the reason for that?
Shortening.
And flexion deformity.
To compensate for the shortening.
And flexion deformity.
Yes.
So it, in effect that other hip is always in adduction.
Adduction.
So it has gradually subluxated, eroded out, subluxated, degenerative arthritis. What will you do? What will you do?
What is your management? What is your age now?
50 years.
She can live for another 25 years.
Yes.
What do you do now?
I have to...
You look at the way she walks back. Yes, what do you do?
Total knee replacement.
Total knee replace.
This patient, where you will put the knee? Total knee, where you will put?
This cordyceps mechanism is completely damaged.
Damaged.
It's a bullosis in an unacceptable position.
What should be the position of the knee?
What is the acceptable position in the knee?
Hip in knee in extension, 10 degree of flexion, 10 to 20.
Knee in acceptable position.
Extended or 5 degree flexion?
It's an extended position.
Full extension?
No. How much?
15
degrees of flexion.
Yes, then? For the opposite hip.
How much shortening is there?
A segmental shortening of 3 centimeters.
Total shortening?
Apparent shortening is more. There is no femoral segment, there is no shortening.
Is there a real shortening?
Yeah.
True shortening.
True shortening.
Segmental, which bone attributed?
Joint lines are not palpable, so I think...
You can take the limb length from the anterior superior span to the medial malleolus and compare.
Yes.
How much shortening?
3 centimeters.
Only 3 centimeters.
After that, what you will do? You have corrected, you have made this limb, deformity is corrected. Then what you will do?
You have corrected the deformity. Now it is in acceptable position. What will you do?
Then I can mobilize the patient, assess for the hip joints.
She has, you seen the hip joint,
yes,
isn't it?
Already developed problems in the joint, subluxation, arthritis.
Yes. So when the length gets corrected, it may...
Subluxation will come inside.
When the knee is corrected, the hip will become normal automatically?
You have seen it degenerated, it is subluxated.
Yes. So we may... we have to do a shortening and...
Shortening of the opposite hip.
Anything else you can do?
Total hip replacement.
Why are you so reluctant to say that?
Subluxated, degenerated hip.
It's an accepted treatment. Yes. So you can say that. Provided you correct the knee, you can do it. But if you don't treat this knee, you can never treat the opposite side, because the cause of this problem is on the opposite side. Okay, you should correct that shortening, then flexion deformity. If you can correct it, then you can think of totally.
Totally perfect. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We will not come back in the next year as the delegates, because I expect all of the exam going students pass their examination. Now we have a small function here. There are two awards we have arranged, the best present award for the long case and best present award for the long short case. Dr. Harsh Naveen Chandra from Pune, where is he? Is he here? He has been awarded the best long case presenter, long case presentation award. Anybody from Pune of Viscose Plants, somebody can come and collect it. This is to be given away by Dr. K.C. Gopalakrishnan sir. Dr. Khotra Shivakumar, is he here?
Yes.
Give him a big hand. He can come and accept from Dr. C.M. Kumaran. Dr. Khotra, he is going to tell us his 3 days of experience. Say a few words, your opinion regarding all aspects, regarding the scientific section, the audiovisual aids, the food, transportation, registration, all other arrangements. You can say a few words, either good or bad words, whatever it is you feel.
I have attended other PG teaching courses also, but I sincerely feel this is the best course I have ever attended. The main advantage being all the candidates are put in the real exam scenario. That's what I felt here, because all the faculty were very much experienced, and they're conducting this as it is going in a real exam. So I think that's the main difference.
Any delegates from the among the audience want to tell us something about their experience and what to be improved in the next year, what to be changed? You might have experienced many things, all aspects, including the scientific section, the academic activities. At least two or three of you can come forward and tell us, please.
Good afternoon, I am Dr. Nitin from Father Miller's Medical College, Mangalore. This is the first time I have come for the Calicut Ortho course. I'm exam going and hopefully I will not be coming here next year. These 3 days have been phenomenal in terms of the exposure to the variety of cases that we have got, and I'm extremely happy that none of us missed out on any of the cases that were presented, which was a fallacy I found in another teaching program which I had attended previously, because being divided into groups dilutes the study material. And the amount of knowledge that all the resource persons here, sirs, that you have given out from your years of experience is something that cannot be compared to anything we will ever achieve or read up or learn by ourselves, sir. I sincerely thank each and every one of you on behalf of all of us here. And to the organizers, I would like to thank you, sirs, all of you, the Calicut Medical College Orthopedic Department, for having conducted this course
I know how hard it must be to collect and to coordinate such a big event, but as a postgraduate, to be able to have 3 days of intensive teaching, case after case, findings, discussions, treatment options, is something that each one of us will treasure and cherish, because I know for a fact that 3 days by myself, learning something anywhere, I will not be able to acquire as much as I have in these 3 days. And everything here went on smoothly one after another. The only thing I found faulty was that I did not know what was coming up next. When I came in the morning, I only then know what was going to happen probably. So apart from that, I don't have anything else to say against or anything to add for next year's improvement. Thank you.
Anybody else? Don't hesitate, please come forward and tell me. Tell us.
Dr. Mohan from Metropolitan Hospital, Thrissur, final year DNB. This Calicut course is, the faculty is eminent faculty because all are from the prominent medical college, HODs, DNB examiners, MS examiners. Only thing is, if we improve the venue, it can draw students from all over India. Now, only the half of Indian students are coming. If the venue is better and the big venue, it will be conduct like IOCon, like that. The faculty is best. Only thing is, it should be conducted in a large scale to take to the next better level. Thank you.
Anybody else? I invite our seat.
I have no doubt that what I should say, because this has become something like a ritual that I may have to be saying something. I have to tell you that organizing a clinical training program like this requires effort, time, and dedication. The people behind this are not being projected, and I, from my bottom of my heart, that you are doing the best of the best possible you can do for the next generation to come. As I said in the inaugural function, giving to the poor and helping the needy is the first and foremost thing. If you believe in God, that is what the Almighty want to have. I can see that some of you have been deprived of the benefits because of the overworked consultants in with whom you are working. It is not because of the lack of interest, because some of you have not been able to learn and express your views in a public place like that. But that is not the end of the day. If you talk about the philosophical learning process of Egalavyan, you must have heard of Egalavyan. He was deprived of learning archery in presence of Arjuna and the Pandavans by Dronacharya. None other than Dronacharya was requested by Egalavyan that Adiyane archery padikan anugrahikane ennu paranju. But because of the caste system which was controlling our society of those days, designated professional experience was not permitted to him, but he was determined that I will learn archery from Dronacharya himself. So in the place where these educational programs has been given to the Pandavans, he was sitting in front of, in the top of a tree, and learned every bit of it. And the open declaration of proficiency by the king of that time invited anyone can come here and do the test in front of the august audience. This gentleman
the Yeragalambian walked in and said, people have stopped him. People have stopped him that he can't do. Who is your guru? Who is your guru? He said, my guru is Dronacharya. Then he got angry. The Dronacharya, his physical will has prevented him that you have not given the Guru Darshana. So he was willingly given his right thumb tip as Guru Darshana as requested by Dronacharya. But he went on to win the contest. The moral of the story, whether it is a fabricated story, if there is a will, I am sure there will be a way to heal. And some of you, I was reminded that whenever I go and sit in the as an examiner, I always remember how I was when people like you are actually presenting. So I have not forgotten. That memory is so vivid. I am convinced that there is nothing other than hard work to succeed in this life. And if you are not able to succeed in this life, is perhaps your share of contribution to the learning process has not been complete. I'm sure any teacher who is going to come here, you can be wonder that people are sitting here discussing from A to Z of any single case to take you to the next generation to perpetuate the orthopedic education. And I take this opportunity without any hesitation or reservation, and the Calicut Orthopedic Department is doing an excellent job without looking for any reward or remuneration to be coming out. There is nothing else you can say. You can really proud that you are standing ahead of everybody in India or in the world where academic programs are being conducted. And keep it up, and it is a very great pleasure to be pressure. If you can't defeat them, you stay with them. Nobody can defeat Calicut Orthopedic Department, so you have to be staying with them. I am sure this is the way forward for learning orthopedic. I may appear very rude when you are actually presenting case, but in my heart of heart, I am thinking or feeling your own pulse when I am sitting in the opposite side. What I want to do, you have to be prepared. You have to be prepared to face the worst person in your examiner. But mind you, Deepam Kayil Ullavan Ennum Logam Deepamayam. What I was trying to say, if you've got stuff in you, if you've got basic knowledge in you, nobody in this world can fail you, defeat you, and never violate from some basic principle. Never take away from your basic principle. And I wish you all success. And if not coming here next year to learn to examination, I'm sure some of you will be coming as faculty to continue the mantle of this educational program. Thank you very much.
A few words from Dr. Edward Nestor.
Respected senior teachers, my friends and dear students, this has been a great pleasure staying 3 days in Calicut and learning lot of things. We have come as a faculty, but I tell you, I've been coming for the last 3 years now, and over the past 3 years I've become a good examiner by attending this course, because lot of things we learn here. And one of the things, as Dr. Gopalakrishna sir said, we have found that some of you are presenting the case for the first time, and you will be appearing for the exam shortly. But your institutions where you are studying, probably there is an environment where you are not able to present the cases. I think one of the best things what you can do is you can present the cases to each other. You take up the case, present the cases to each other, at least you get a fluency. You get a some sort of a confidence, because that is very important. If you are confidently present the case, it most of the time half of the exam is won. This is a very important thing to be remembered. So if you do not have a facility, you do not have an environment, don't get hesitated. Present the cases to each other. Seniors can present to the junior, juniors can present to the senior. And every institute, there will be somebody, some senior, some teacher who is interested to teach. Catch hold of him, disturb him, irritate him and present the case. That is the best way you can learn. And I wish you all the best in your exams. And as sir has already blessed you, I also wish that all of you pass in your next exam, and we don't want to see you here as again delegates, but probably as faculty. Thank you very much.
Few words from Dr. C.M. Kumaran, one of our senior faculty, who was the senior faculty of
3 days. I feel that this is very nicely conducted, very successfully conducted teaching program. I also learned many things during the last 3 days. I take this opportunity to congratulate Dr. Gauma, Dr. Kumaran Chettiar, Subramaniam, and all other members of the Department of Orthopedics of this institution for this successful conduct of this program. And I wish all the delegates success in the coming examinations. Thank you.
Few words from Dr. M.A. Thomas, Professor M.A. Thomas.
Respected faculties, so first of all, I bow my head in front of the organizers, because the amount of pain they have taken to organize such a large event is very difficult. I know the difficulties, because such an enormous amount of clinical materials. So even after today, their problems are not going to over, because these patients are going back to the ward. They have to dispose them, they have to treat them. Only we have discussed this, diagnosed. So the management is remaining. So it may take months to operate on these patients and manage these patients. First of all, I appreciate the effort and the difficulties faced by the Calicut Department of Orthopedics. The next thing I have to say to the delegates is that, so most of the delegates from private hospitals, especially DNB candidates, so there are many problems for them, especially there may not be any regular classes for them. Moreover, the clinical materials may be very deficient there. So you have seen a large array of cases here, and you are not going to see in your whole career in the hospital such an amount of cases. So you make use of that, and my advice is that you should not stop here. So you have already started from here, and brush up your knowledge. As Edward Nasrat said, you go and present cases in between them, or you yourself can present, taking the case genuinely and present, so that you can improve. So I wish all success in your postgraduate course and examination, wishing you all.
Thank you, sir. Few words by Dr. Gopi.
Respected dignitaries, on and off the dais, my dear friends and colleagues. First of all, let me thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity for a few words on the podium. I was sitting here for the last 3 days, and when I was going out of the hall, I was literally dissected by each one of you, because you were asking every type of questions even outside the hall. So I can understand how much interest you have in this subject. Probably you are all exam going, and after the exam you will forget everything, I don't know. But at least today, you are very much interested. But what I have understood from interaction with you is that you know everything, but you are not able to take out one point when examiners like Professor Gopakumar sir or Valashin sir is asking. You are not able to take it out at the right time. But you talked to me that I knew it, but I could not take it out when the examiner asked. So that's why this course will allow you to arrange your knowledge in your mind in such a way that you will be able to take it out one by one when the situation comes. For example, as I told, if you have a patient with a bone tumor, you should at least settle in your mind saying that I'll confirm the diagnosis, I'll stage the disease, and I'll institute definitive management. You have to be sure about that. In ward rounds, somebody asks you, there is an emergency, what will you do? Then you should say that I'll resuscitate the patient.
I'll confirm the diagnosis and I'll stay, I then institute definitive management. In a casualty situation, if you say that I'm going to confirm the diagnosis before you treat or resuscitate, you're going to fail. So what is important is that you have to arrange your knowledge in your mind in such a way that you will be able to take it out one by one when somebody asks. When you read an X-ray, you should know what is the systematic method of reading the X-ray. For example, an X-ray pelvis is kept. You start from pelvis saying that Perkins line, transacetabular line, episubluxated, Kohler's line, teardrop, neck shaft angle. As you come down like that, you will not miss anything. But what candidates are telling that when you see the hip, they say there is sclerosis in the head. There is a cyst in the head. So there is no systematic method of reading. Probably because you are not getting a regular class. So great professors like this will definitely guide you in reading the X-rays, in approaching the patient. So what is important is the right way to approach the case and arrive at a diagnosis. I am not taking much of your time, but you are, I mean, all great and you presented very well. The organizers did a great job. Now this is the 13th year of this meeting and I say that you will all have a nice time and we will meet again in some other situation, not in the same setting. So all the best to all of you and the organizers.
And finally, word of thanks by our organizing secretary, Dr. Subramanian.
So respected dignitaries in the dais, senior faculties, and my dear colleagues and delegates, when I took up the responsibility of organizing this program, I did not have that fire in my belly to move on, as I thought it, what to say, a Herculean task. But the relentless support and encouragement from all the staff members of my department imparted the inner drive in me to move forward. On the behalf of the organizing committee of Calicut Orthocourse, let me first express my sincere gratitude to all our faculties who come here for enlightening us with their knowledge and skills. I thank our beloved and respected head of the institution for spending time during the inaugural function. Let me also specially thank Professor T.S. Gopakumar, head of our department, who has always been a good guide to all my works beginning from my postgraduate days. Thank you, sir, for your valuable suggestions. I thank Dr. Kumaran Chettiar, organizing chairman of this course, for his suggestions and advice to smoothly conduct this program. I thank Dr. Jojo, associate professor, and my predecessor as the organizing secretary for his timely help, suggestions and guidance. Dr. Rajesh Purushottam and Dr. Sibin, who arranged all the cases, and Dr. Balaji for arranging the food, and treasurer Dr. B. Ravikumar, and all others in the department for their timely help and suggestions. Let me also express my gratitude to patients and their bystanders for spending their valuable time and helping us to take knowledge from examining them. Without the help of my postgraduate students, I would have reached nowhere. I thank all my postgraduate students, especially Dr. Sujit Rao and his good team, for their excellent work to conduct this CME. Last but not the least, I specially thank all our paramedical staff, students and audiovisual people and all the other behind the stage helpers who have played an important role in the conduction for this program. And I thank the authorities to arrange this, to allow this hall and the another hall for conducting the program smoothly. I request all to forgive for any pitfalls or lacunae in the conduction of this program, and I am looking forward for your valuable suggestions for future improvement. And wish you best of luck for your future exams. So I wish you have borne your voyage to back to your hometown. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
I take this opportunity to give a standing ovation to the organizers who has taken a lot of pains because they have been instrumental in conducting this year.
Thank you very much.
Shishamangi